Hello, aviation enthusiasts, and welcome back to Histories of Airliners. Ever catch yourself wandering through an air and space museum, gazing up at all those magnificent metal giants? Well, today, we're diving deep into the world of preserved aviation history, but with a laser focus on a true icon, the Douglas DC-9. Forget fleeting glimpses. We're going on a journey to seek out the incredible DC-9s that have been saved from the scrapper's torch. From meticulously restored airframes gleaming under museum lights to unique examples carefully maintained for other purposes. We'll explore the stories that these grounded birds still have to tell. Get ready to step back in time and witness the enduring legacy of this legendary airliner. Okay, so picture this. Way back in the 1960s, Air Canada got this brand new shiny DC-9. The tail number of Charlie Foxtrot-Tango Lima Lima. This wasn't just any plane. It became a real workhorse, zipping all over North America for over 30 years. Can you even imagine all the people that flew it and all those hours in the air? A whopping 81,558 hours. That's more than any other DC-9 had. Think about all the stories that plane could tell. Now get this, instead of ending up in some scrapyard, this particular DC-9 got a pretty sweet retirement. After its last flight in Air Canada colors back in 2002, they actually gave it to the Canada Aviation and Space Museum up in Ottawa. And get this, they even painted it back to how it looked when it was first delivered. So now, you can actually go see it, this real piece of Canadian flying history, standing there and reminding you of all those journeys it took. Pretty cool, huh? Next on our list, there's this DC-9 number November 1332U, right? It came off the line way back in 1969 as a DC-9-31. For ages, it was island hopping within Hawaiian Airlines. Think sunshine and short hops. After its time in Hawaii, it would fly for Allegheny, Southern Airways, Republic Airlines, and then in 1986, it joined Northwest, becoming plane number 9935. Can you picture all those flights, crisscrossing the U.S. and maybe even further? This plane really flew. Like a crazy 88,708 hours and over 94,000 flights. Sadly, it ended up in Florida in a scrapyard in 2010. But get this, the cockpit got actually rescued. Initially, it was saved by a collector as an inoperative cockpit section. Then, in 2013, it was purchased for a conversion into a cockpit simulator all the way in the Czech Republic. So even though the whole plane isn't around anymore, you can still hop in the cockpit and get a feel for what it was like to fly in this old-school jet. Pretty wild, huh? Now, the third aircraft on our list, this DC-9, registered as November 333 Lima, has a pretty significant story. It started flying way back in 1968 and spent a long time with Delta. You know, rocking that classic widget, including the 1976 variant for the Bicentennial, and flying all over the U.S. But here's where it gets heavy. After flying with Delta, Ozark, and TWA, this aircraft was bought up by a parts distribution company that broke it up, with most of the airplane spending its time at the Marana Air Park in Arizona, except for the cockpit section, which is displayed inside the Schiphol International Airport, painted in a KLM livery that it never wore during its passenger-paying career. Okay, so this DC-9 has been around the block a few times. It started out in 1971, flying for East African Airways as 5 X-ray-Uniform Victory Yankee. Picture it zipping over the jungles and plains of East Africa. And then in 1977, it switched over to Kenya Airways and gained a new registration. Still doing its thing in Africa, but wait, there's more. In 1989, this plane hopped back across the pond to the United States and became November 942 Mike Lima, flying for Midway Airlines. After that, it even flew for Spirit, and get this, after such a long career, you would think that this plane was headed for the scrap heap, or maybe, if lucky, a museum. However, fate had a different card for parts of this aircraft. The front section was separated from the rest of the aircraft and put on display in the Kazania store in the Central Comercial Santa Fe Mall near Mexico City. All right, let's talk about a DC-9 with a long and faithful career in the skies of Europe and North America. This Douglas DC-9-32 first took to the air in 1968 before being delivered to the Italian flight carrier of Alitalia. For decades, this aircraft diligently shuttled passengers across Italy and into parts of Europe, becoming a familiar sight at countless airports. Imagine in those classic Alitalia colors of the 1960s and the 1970s, a reliable workhorse connecting families, business travelers, and vacationers for years on end. By 1995, this long-serving aircraft would return to the United States wearing the red-top livery of Northwest Airlines and then eventually being retired wearing Northwest's final silver livery. However, instead of meeting the scrapper's torch, it found a new purpose. Today, the forward section of this veteran DC-9 resides in the Kazania, them again, in the Cucucello, located just outside the plaza of Cucucello in-person mall and the southern stretches of Mexico City. You are all not going to believe the story of this DC-9. At the end of its life, registered as X-Ray Alpha-Juliet Echo Bravo, it was built back in 1969, but get this, it wasn't just some regular airliner. Nope, this baby was Hugh Hefner's personal jet. They called it the Big Bunny. It was all black and even had jet bunnies as flight attendants. Can you even imagine the crazy parties and famous people who flew on this thing? But get this, plot twist. Hefner eventually sold it, and in 1976, it was exported to Venezuela to fly for Linea Aeropostale Venezolana, where it flew until 1979. At this point, it became a regular Aeromexico plane called Ciudad Juarez. For years, it just flew regular folks around Mexico, and apparently nobody really made a big deal about its wild past. Then, after it was done flying in 2004, it didn't even get totally scrapped. They actually gave the body of this plane to this city in Mexico for schools to use. Talk about a wild ride for one airplane, going from the Playboy mansion in the sky to an educational tool. Crazy, right? So there's a DC-9 on display at a Kazania. I know, them again. Was it 3 or 4 times now that they've preserved a section of a DC-9? But this one's in Santiago, Chile. And before traveling to Chile, this aircraft would have its first flight from the Long Beach Douglas plant in February of 1967. After that, it would be purchased by Eastern Airlines, who would fly it until they ceased operations in 1991. From there, the aircraft would move on to Midway Airlines for a few years, but unfortunately, we have found no pictures of this aircraft with Midway before it was acquired by Northwest Airlines in 1994. Unlike most aircraft that survived the Delta-Northwest merger, this aircraft continued flying with the final Northwest livery with Delta until 2010. And now, between 2010 and today, it was purchased from its storage location, reconfigured, and flown down to Arau Canal Park in the heart of Santiago, Chile, for its current installation at the aforementioned Kazania in Land Chile colors, an airline that it never flew with. The next aircraft on our list, a Douglas DC-9-51, has quite a story to tell. A real journey through the skies. This plane, built back in 1975, started its flying career with Austrian Airlines, where it was known as Graz, and spent about 10 years soaring over the skies of Europe. Then, in 1985, it came back to the United States and picked up the registration of a November 675 Mike Charlie. Over the next few years, it flew for Muse Air, Transstar Airlines, Eastern Airlines, until that airline folded in 1991, and Continental Airlines, but for less than a year. It finally found a longer-term home with Northwest Airlines in 1992. Eventually, when Northwest merged with Delta Airlines in 2010, November 675 Mike Charlie became part of the Delta fleet. After a long and busy life carrying countless passengers, it was retired in 2013, and now you can find it at the Delta Flight Museum in Atlanta, where it's preserved as a piece of aviation history. Our penultimate aircraft for this video, a U.S. Air Force VC-9C, a military VIP transport variant of the DC-9, has quite a story. This aircraft started its service in the United States Air Force back in February of 1975, and for about 30 years, it was the go-to aircraft for a lot of important government folks, including a remarkable number of U.S. presidents, from Gerald Ford to George W. Bush. It wasn't just any old plane. It carried these presidents, along with vice presidents, first ladies, and cabinet members, on countless trips that required the use of a smaller aircraft to get into airports that were unable to service the 747-based VC-25. This aircraft flew mostly within the United States and around North, Central, and South America, with some journeys even farther afield. After serving faithfully for decades, this distinguished plane was retired in 2005 and is now preserved at the Castle Air Museum in Atwater, California, where it stands as a reminder of its special place in aviation and presidential history. And now for the last aircraft of this Part 1 video. This DC-9 began life in Spain with the flag-carrying Iberia Airlines in the summer of 1972, just 2 weeks after its first flight. After 12 years with Iberia, this aircraft was returned to McDonnell Douglas for conversion into a military transport aircraft for the United States Navy as a C-9 Nightingale. As a side note, I have ridden one of these in the late 1990s on a flight between Jacksonville, Florida and the Portsmouth, New Hampshire Airport as part of a public relations tour into the state of Maine, representing my submarine, the USS Maine, then stationed out of Kings Bay, Georgia. And while this aircraft flew for the United States Navy, it was named the City of Dublin. By 2005, the aircraft had been retired from the United States Navy and picked up for further use by NASA. But by the next year, the aircraft had been reverted back to its U.S. Navy livery and put on display at the Pima Air and Space Museum in Tucson, Arizona. Wow, what a journey in this first part of a video series about preserved DC-9s around the world. We've seen some incredible DC-9s built by Douglas and later on McDonnell Douglas. As we wrap up, let's give a shout out to the amazing people who made it all happen. The engineers, the visionaries, the risk takers who dared to dream big and preserve these historic aircraft that would have otherwise been taken to the scrapper's torch. They didn't just change aviation, they continued to inspire generations to look up and wonder what's beyond the clouds. Thanks for hanging out with me and exploring the world of preserved Douglas DC-9s. If you enjoyed this adventure, hit that subscribe button for more awesome aviation history videos. And if you want to support my work and get some cool bonus content, think about becoming a member or joining my Patreon. Your support means the world to me and helps me make these videos. Till next time, keep your eyes on the skies and never stop exploring.